Welcome back to the news today. This is the Daily Debate. The Islamic State group has proved highly skilled at drafting people from all over the world to join its fight. As we've reported tonight, now in Australia, 15 people have been arrested in raids across Sydney and Brisbane on an Islamic State-related terror plot. Just earlier this week in the U.S., a Rochester man was indicted on an attempt to provide support to the terror group. Joining me tonight is Moty Cristal, former deputy head of negotiation management at the Israeli Prime Minister's office. Good evening.
Good evening, Lucy.
Good to see you back again. And Dr. Jonathan Fine of the International Institute of Counterterrorism. Good evening.
Good evening, you.
Before, gentlemen, we will start talking about IS and their magnificent abilities. Let's see what our viewers have to say about that. Good evening, Noit.
Good evening, Lucy. So this issue of foreign jihadists is, of course, one of the biggest problems with this Islamic State group that we've been discussing on the news today. As you just mentioned, becoming clearer and clearer from Australia to the United States, to Kosovo even. So we asked our viewers tonight this question. We asked them, would you accept tighter border controls to fight jihadism? This is just one of the many solutions that people are debating in how to deal with this group. Let's take a look at the poll that was very extreme. A full 94% said yes, only 4% said no. So I wanted to bring you sort of a range of the yeses because they were really very similar today. All of these viewers, Renee, Corinne, Evelyn, and Gabriel, said really it's too late to deal with borders and that we have to deal with it inside. I'll just read off a few of them. Renee says, obviously, jihadism is a scourge on the world in which we live. To eradicate it, we must use all means and to nip it in the bud. She says border control is important, but it won't be enough. Corinne, with her question mark, says border control should have thought of that quite a long time ago. They're already here. We see really these same kind of comments from a lot of viewers from around the world saying the problem is clearly already inside Australia, inside Europe, inside the United States. Now the issue is how to deal with that. So let's take a look at our other viewers. A couple of them who sort of pointed to what the other solution might be. Haruna said, the closure of borders is not the solution. There must be creation of jobs for youth who give themselves to fake jihad. He says, if not, how many youths? He says, French, American, English, Belgian, these are all recruited for jihad. He asks why, saying that is the question. It's a great point. Why should be the question that I hope the United States and all of these other countries are asking themselves. Why are these youth being attracted in the first place? And let's just end with Roger, who said, you can't control the borders of the internet. That's simply said, a lot of this recruitment is being done on social media. Facebook is the new border. How do you get around that? I'm sure your viewers and your guests can help you on that one. I'll send it back to you.
Yes, definitely. Noit, thank you very much for this. What borders, gentlemen? What borders are we talking about? Can we control the borders? How come the states just right now got up and said, wow, we are facing a big problem? We didn't see that it's happening and knocking on our doors. And actually, we helped them grow up here.
Well, first of all, I think that the ideological aspect is very important, especially when you deal with the religious radical groups, all fundamental religious groups. One of Osama bin Laden and his ideological mentor, Abdullah Yusuf Azzam's major, unfortunately, achievement, already going back to the late 80s, early 90s, was to market and sell an idea. For instance, volunteers who joined Al-Qaeda had to fill up a form. Some of these forms were found by the United States, by the American Army in Afghanistan. One of the questions was, are you ready to embark on istishhad? Are you ready to embark on sacrifice? Every Muslim kid from the age of three knows what that means. The success is by marketing and spreading. And it's very hard to fight an idea or kill. You can kill a terrorist. You know, you can kill the commanders. You can chase the leaders. But in the end of the day, this idea spread all around. We have the Afghan alumni, and now we're going to have the Syrian, Iraqi, Daesh alumni spreading all over. So that's problem number one. As for the volunteers that are now pouring by the thousands from Europe, from Russia into Syria and Iraq, I think it's important to pay attention to the entrance and exit routes that they're taking. You board an air, if you're a young jihadist advocator living in London, Paris, Madrid, or Frankfurt or Berlin, you have to board an airplane or take a train going to Istanbul and Ankara. From there, you take a bus to the Turkish-Syrian border, and you're in. This is, by the way, where the Turkish security services and military forces, I think, can contribute much more in order to stop this, because everybody's realizing how this is working. They go to Turkey. From Turkey, they go in. Now, they're not making any felony by going to Turkey, and nobody really knows what they're doing when they cross the border, and nobody knows what they did when they come back. So when they come back with their EU passports, they're on the way back to Paris, London, Berlin, or Madrid. But these patterns are known already. If you take the two incidents in France and Brussels of attacking Jewish targets, for example, there were red lights all around these people.
Exactly about the red lights I want to talk, and I want to talk about the inner problem, because this is something that the West faced all the time. It was in front of the West eyes, it was in front of the United States eyes, it's not something that came...
There's nothing new about this.
There's nothing new about it, so how come they're waking up just now?
They're waking up because of the smart use of ICE, of the social media, and you use very strong visuals. It is like Hollywood movies, all the very good setting, orange dress, black, desert.
It looks like a chapter in Homeland.
Exactly, and they know exactly what buttons to press, because what will drive more and more volunteer is that more and more Western government will decide to fight against it. It is a cycle or a circle that actually the only way to fight it is if you can bring a counter idea. And this is the core deficiency of the West, because the jihadists do have the jihadist ideology. What the West has to counter it? Liberalism? It doesn't work. Humanism? It doesn't work. It's definitely not sexy to attract young
people.
Being
too much politically correct with some groups, with ethnic groups.
Exactly.
Living in the West.
Like the UK praises multiculturalism, and we know exactly what does it breeds. So I think, you know, to be a little bit cynical, and I came back now from 3 days in Sydney where they, you know, they brought up the security alert. The West start to understand that Israel is not the problem, and they slowly start to see what we are facing here. And I think it's about time to say, yeah, we put against the jihadist ideology the ideology that we are willing to sacrifice our life and our way of life to fight this.
So we are willing to sacrifice our life and our way of life to fight this, but again, isn't it a little bit too late? Isn't it by starting with the education? Just when France started imposing laws like preventing people from going with burqa or any religious symbols, it's what? It's not understanding the people that you brought to your own country, that you opened the gates and you let them in, and it's not understanding the minorities that are living in your countries?
Well, first of all, it's never too late. You know, I mean, better late awakening than nothing. Just to go back for a moment, what really woke them up, and this is sort of a double-faced attitude. Israel was criticized after 50 days of fighting and receiving 200 rockets and mortar bombs a day, asking Israel to restrain itself and to be proportionate. If you look at what happened here, IS has been running around Syria and Iraq already for the past 3 years. The whole phenomenon began in 2000 with Abu Musab al-Zarqawi. There's nothing new about this. When did the West really wake up? Let's be precise. Not when 400 Yazidis were buried alive or 700 Shiites were shot dead in a style that wouldn't shame the Einsatzgruppen in the Eastern Front in World War II. When two Americans and one British national were decapitated by a British accent-speaking executioner. That's when the West finally woke up, and President Obama declares real war, and declares almost world war on an organization that is two-thirds of the size of Hezbollah, not much bigger, though more or less like Hamas. I mean, you know, in the end of the day, let's put things here in proportion. The West also has a very serious problem. If you look at the EU, there are a lot of Western people in Europe and the US who believe in liberal democracy. Okay, the President of the United States believes in it with all its heart. The problem is that you can't take this concept and way of life and force it on two-thirds of the people of this planet who don't believe in it and don't buy it. And this is something the West has to wake up to if it wants to confront what's going to come down the road, especially in Europe, by the way, more than any place.
Yes.
I'm listening very carefully to what my friend Jonathan is saying, and I cannot agree more. It's not too late to wake up. It's too late to lose the naivete of the West and to start to listen without criticism to what people who live in this very violent neighborhood believes and think. I'm a negotiator. People ask me, should we negotiate with these people? Should we engage with these people? And I say, yes, definitely. And at the same time, continue to pursue, continue to act, continue to fight, continue to bomb. And if there is a need to engage in order to gather information, in order to pursue their shelters, I will negotiate, I will reach out, I will engage. Because this is exactly what they are doing. What is the counter-terrorism moves that the Western governments are doing on the internet rather than defensive? Are we re-recruiting people? Are we going after the families of the volunteers? This is against Western perspective. But if any volunteer, if any volunteer whom his name is known to the security agencies all around Europe, the family will gently ask to leave the country. This is kind of a countermeasure which democracies should take, for example. And that will start giving these volunteers the cost, showing them the cost, and will deter the communities, because the disease is in the mosques, in the communities, in the UK, in Australia, with this naive or liberal ideas. We are in a war, and it's better late than never.
I think, by the way, I think one of the edifying lessons after 9/11, after what we saw, what happened in the Hamburg Mosque, where the 9/11 cell was basically created, Pillsbury Mosque in London, the Brooklyn Mosque, the Blind Sheikh in New York, is that security services both in the U.S. and Europe did start monitoring community centers and mosques. But just like Moti said here, this is a very serious challenge for people who believe in civil rights and liberal democracy, which are values that we do all love to share. But in this kind of war, the rules of engagement are very different, and the West has to go through a drastic change of mindset if it wants to win this war. You can't deal with ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Hamas, Hezbollah, Boko Haram, El-Shabaab, any of these organizations the same way you deal with a liberal, democratic... it's not going to work.
I'm asking you, gentlemen, how? How? Because sometimes when we're here sitting down and debating about the relationship between Israel and the Arab countries and Israel and Hamas, sometimes we're saying that, okay, Israel, in one way or another, doesn't understand the language, doesn't speak the language, doesn't understand the culture, doesn't speak, understand the music. And it seems that the West either? It seems that the United States didn't understand the culture, West didn't understand. How do you fight this?
Here I think that I start to a little bit differ from my friend Jonathan about putting all these organizations together. It is true that these organizations use terror as a means to pursue their interest. However, there is a significant difference between jihadist organizations and jihadist movement with a global jihadist agenda and national terror organization like Hezbollah and Hamas. It is true that they share recruitment tactics. It is true that they share cruelty. It is true that they share terrorist patterns. However, the root cause is different, and the agenda they pursue. Why I'm saying it? I'm saying it because, again, from a negotiation point of view, nationalistic organization like Hamas and Hezbollah can be deterred on an instrumental interest level. They do have national interest in Lebanon, in Palestine, which Al-Qaeda or IS do not have, same as Boko Haram in Nigeria. So there is a difference, and these differences and the logic of their fight should be the planning, or should be used when we plan our response. And it cannot be automatic.
But I would like to relate to this. The common denominator, for example, to all the radical Sunni groups that I mentioned before, Akim, Al-Qaeda in the Maghreb, Boko Haram, Nigeria, Al-Shabaab, Somalia, Al-Qaeda, Hamas, ISIS, is that they all ideologically stem from the Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood. On the macro-level ideology, drinking from the fountain of Hassan al-Banna, Sayyid Qutb, Abdallah Salam Faraj, and all these people, there is a common denominator. Take Hamas, for example. One of the ways Hamas always gets across the war, or sort of gets around the corner, is by marketing the nationalistic agenda, which you're right, they have a very strong Palestinian national agenda. But when you read the Hamas charter from August 1988, you also find a total support and advocation of global jihad. When you look at posters in Gaza, you see Abdallah Yusuf Azam, Al-Qaeda, Zawahiri. You can't totally detach them from that, although I agree with you that they have different local agendas as well. This is an argument we'll never finish here today.
Another 16 minutes. Gentlemen, thank you very much
for coming
to the studio. We're going out for a small break, 2-minute break, and then we will be back. Don't go anywhere for the one-on-one.